Hopefully it's starting to come through in just a second. Let me know if
yeah,
you see it.
You see it?
All right. Hey everyone, I'm Brad Smith. I've been with Red Hat since late 2017. I'm the engineering team lead for the cloudigrade project, aka CloudMeter. The slide here I have really should say automated gating, promotion, and deployments, but I couldn't really fit all that in. Also have a long story to try to cover in about 10 minutes, so I'll be speaking kind of fast. Hopefully my frenetic pace can keep you awake if the caffeine isn't working for you. So we're a small team. If you don't know us, cloudigrade is a console.service that orchestrates commands in AWS, Azure's in development, other clouds TBD. We identify, track, and report with high precision all the stuff you see here for customers running RHEL in the cloud. And that's whether they're using an image provided by Red Hat or one that they've built from scratch, which is especially useful if, like I think Justin and Rich mentioned earlier, they don't have our telemetry like Subman or Discovery enabled, or if they have network policies that block it from phoning home. But anyway, I'm not here to talk about what we do, rather some of our automation. And I expect a lot of what I'm about to show might be reviewed for you. Some of you have probably already done some of this. But if your services code promotion and service deployment are not yet fully hands-off automated with tests and going to stage and going to prod, which reminder we saw as a quarterly goal in VK slides yesterday, then we're happy to share our experience. Why is it important? Yes, obviously your managers are asking for it. But time is money, context switching is expensive, and importantly, having really good predictable automation will empower you to focus on solving the more interesting challenges and helping our customers' problems. Background on how my team works. Like I suspect most of us do, our team loves automation. We're also a big supporter of that release early, release often principle. And we've always expected that whatever's in our main branch is in production or will be very soon. And that's a notion that's very important to embrace if you want to have an effective continuous deployment strategy. A quick history on how we got here today, because I think our story is kind of interesting. In 2018, we were deploying a live pilot. Before years ago, none of today's SRE or console dot infrastructure existed. There was no app interface, no cloud or no bonfire, not even E3 deployed. But since we do love automation, we built some of our own. And in 2018, cloudigrade had fully automated deployments from gitlab.com to OpenShift for both our stage and prod environments. Conceptually, it's pretty similar to what we have today. It automatically triggered when one of us created a tag on the main branch. It built and verified and pushed all the things. It was super fast and simple, but it was a bespoke solution. It didn't trigger any E3 integration tests, but we did have a separate pipeline for that. And it couldn't manage any Red Hat service dependencies. So the platform evolved. And with that GitLab experience behind us, we knew that things could be really great for everybody. So like BK said yesterday, we complained a bit, maybe I complained a bit, but I like to think of it as more, we were squeaky wheel, we needed some attention. And so we regularly pushed some folks, prioritized changes in different places that can make deployments really good for everybody, not just for us, but for the whole team. So where are we today? We have tossed out that old GitLab process. We're now fully integrated with App Interface and Friends. And the process that we use is still super easy for day-to-day operations. And any team can implement it, probably should, given those previously stated org level goals of having IQE tests gating all the projects going forward. For us, there's really only two manual steps to release something, and that's pretty much the best you can get. First, someone writes new code for our project and opens a pull request on our repo. Then automation starts taking over some things, unit tests, lint checks, verifying example docs, verifying OpenAPI JSON, test code coverage and code cov, hooking into Red Hat's internal sonar queue to check vulnerabilities and code smells. And here's where things might start looking a little different from other projects. We have IQE deploying cloudigrade and its dependencies to a thermal namespace. It generates real data in a real AWS account, creates sources that for that real account, runs integration tests, tears it all down, and that's all done as part of a PR check. As you can see on the screenshot on the side. When all those checks pass, then the second and only other manual step is for another developer on the team, the one with maintainer status, approve the PR so it can merge. And we go totally hands off once again as automation takes over. When the code lands on the main branch, one job builds tags and pushes our image up to key IO, another deploys it to stage. And as part of our deployment, it includes things like applying DB migrations. And another job deploys a special short-lived pod to run IQE's smoke test against stage. And when that succeeds, the next step goes on to promote and deploy it to prod, and we're basically done. Oof. On top of all that, we're also seeing various automated messages appear in Slack to notify us through the process as things are succeeding or failing. These are extremely helpful for us to understand the deployment process, since we have completely left it to the bots to do all the work. We're not paying any attention most of the time, frankly, because we don't need to. The span of life from hitting the approve button in GitHub to actually seeing everything live in prod takes about 30 minutes. Right now, the IQE smoke test is by far the slowest part of that setup. That will vary significantly by your project's complexities, how many systems you have to touch. In our case, we have to create that real data in AWS, and seeing something flow through the process, through the whole system, can take a little time, even though the smoke is just a minimal piece of our overall large set of use cases. So breaking down where are the commands for each step after you define, unfortunately, I have to hand wave even more here because I don't have enough time. And frankly, this could be a whole talk of its own. Let me just say it's complicated. Here's a lot of links. These are literally a copy of the notes we keep in our wiki. So if anyone, if one of us gets hit by a bus or wins the lottery, everyone else on the team knows where and how things are defined so they can maintain it going forward. Seriously, it's all in our public GitHub wiki, links to source files, et cetera. Go take a look if you're interested. The good news though, is that even though there are a lot of places to coordinate, most of it's YAML, most of it's an app interface, and most of it's covered by SRE's onboarding process, as mentioned just a few minutes ago. So definitely go check out the onboarding process if you're not already onboarded or if you're in the process of being onboarded. All that being said, I'm going to try to take the next minute or so to speed run and list every one of the automated steps in our process. All right, GitHub Actions define jobs that we can publicly run for unit tests, linting, et cetera. Our test script pushes coverage data to CodeCov, which responds to PR. GitHub webhooks ping CI inf Jenkins to run SonarQube. GitHub webhooks ping CI x Jenkins to run IQE tests. When code lands on the main branch, GitHub webhooks ping CI x Jenkins to build our container image and push it to key. An OpenShift SAS deploy pipeline picks up any OpenShift template changes and deploys it to stage with the image. And our deployment init container commands, we run shell scripts and Ansible playbooks to apply database migrations and ensure resources are correctly configured in AWS. When that successfully completes, it publishes to cloudigrade stage deploy success channel, which another app interface resource is subscribed to. And when it sees the ping, it deploys an image to stage that runs the IQE smoke test against stage. When that smoke test succeeds, it's pipeline publishes to cloudigrade stage post deploy test success channel. I know it's a long name. That being said, meanwhile, the productions app interface resource has subscribed to that channel. And importantly, the production side has auto true setting to promotion, which means when the prod's namespace definition sees those stage tests succeed, the prod piece will create and self-approve a new merge request in app interface to bump the prod commit hash. And since there's a new commit hash, that kicks off a prod deployment as the usual SRE app interface does. And our deployment includes the usual shell scripts and playbooks for prods, and we're done. Now, when you list out every single piece of the equation like that, it might sound kind of wild, but please remember that once you understand that each step is progressively building into the next, it's really not so bad. And it's actually pretty reasonable once you actually have it working and looking at it all together. Let's see, a couple of FAQs I've seen. How long did it take for us to set this up? We're kind of a special case. For us, it took several months at the least, but I should qualify that by saying that we were an early adopter and we were pushing a lot of the boundaries at the time and we were waiting a lot, waiting for features to be implemented and bugs to be fixed and app interface and Clouder and whatnot. For example, having the PR check deploy in a VMware environment or having the stage smoke test actually updating from a production commit hash. Those are big critical pieces. But now all of that hard work is done. I would guess that for a new team getting onto this, a more current answer might be a few weeks. A lot of that's just going to be reading and learning and talking to people. I'm not really sure, but the code is relatively small compared to getting it all into your brain. I would definitely encourage you to take a look at our code or similar projects. Read the SRE docs. Maybe find a buddy in SRE who can help you set things up because there might be some steps that need their approval. Another question I've been asked, is it stable? What kind of problems do we normally encounter? Yes, it is nominally stable. Early on, we were having a lot of problems with that whole auto merge thing not really working, but that's all hand waved and working now. We do pretty regularly have problems with IQE tests failing unexpectedly, and we have to go restart its pipeline manually, which is just finding and clicking a button. And frankly, the rest of it just picks up and automates after that just fine. And I think that's really a problem with the IQE tests themselves. They're a little flaky, which is a whole other conversation. But test definitions aside, the overall process is solid. It works just fine. What do I or my team or what can you get out of doing this? For me personally, there are two key things. Thing number one is divorcing the routine kind of mindless maintenance work that is looking up commit hashes, manually running a test, asking people, hey, is it okay to deploy, or checking different environments from our day-to-day operations. We don't do that. That's not anything we think about. Secondly, I don't have to get on the VPN, which is a really nice perk. I kind of hate doing that, and I don't have to do a bunch of extra work just to ship a fix. When I fix something, something in the code in GitHub, I just do that in GitHub, and I go work on something else. Life goes on. Anything else that you should know that I haven't mentioned yet? This is maybe a small thing or a big thing, depending on how you work. And I think Dave Johnson kind of touched on this a little bit earlier when he talked about that inner loop stuff. Having ITV gate both your PRs and your prod release pipeline means that your project's devs and QEs have to work together on the same issues at the same time. That might seem obvious hearing me say it, but I do know from experience that there are a lot of teams within Red Hat where the devs will code up something and they'll just pitch it over the fence for QE and hope for the best. And then maybe a few days or a week later, QE will get around to it, and then they go figure out how to release it. No, you have to learn how to swarm, you need to actively communicate, and you have to work together as one whole unit. All right, links and details are in these slides, which I'm sure will be shout out shortly. All the information I showed earlier is also in my project's GitHub project wiki under github.com/cloudigrade. There's a page called Release Process. Surprise, that's what it is. Or definitely feel free to reach out to me if you would like to know more. Thanks.
Awesome, thank you. It looks like there are a couple of questions on the chat. I'll just read them out.
Yeah.
The first one is, in cloudigrade, how many commits go to your repo in a typical day?
In a typical day, maybe zero, maybe 10. It is highly variable to depending on what we're working on. I think the underlying question there is how often are we releasing? And this is very much going to the heart of the continual release. Sometimes we'll go days without a release to production. Sometimes we'll have 2, 3, or 4 releases to production in the same day, since the whole thing is automated, click it, and you wait 30 minutes and it's done.
Very cool. Next one is, how do you resolve cross-project dependencies? For example, like if you use another service and then they had to add a new API or change something or fix a bug for you, and then you have to kind of make changes on your end to consume that.
Yeah, that's a good question. Fortunately, we haven't had a whole lot of that. And usually that gets held up during the development branch PR process, is if we expect something coming up for service X that we depend on or vice versa, we'll just hold that in the branch until we're ready. And then we kind of manually coordinate it. That's definitely not an ideal thing. That might also be something that could be handled like feature flags, which is, I know, a growing of interest sort of thing that the platform is working on. We're not yet using feature flags, but we might have to adopt that if we want to really get this going to solve that kind of problem going forward.
And then, just to add on to that, like a lot of time, not all the time, but many times, you can kind of develop it in such a, whatever you're doing, in such a way where it can kind of work with both. And then once the other thing is released, you can take out the code that's no longer used.
Yeah, we try to make all of our changes as backward compatible as possible, where possible. Yeah.
Yeah, but yeah, I know it's not like a 100% solution, but I know in Drift they've done that a couple of times before. Question about VPN. I think a lot of the stuff we use isn't like, for like Google and stuff, I don't think we go through we only go through VPN for Red Hat services. Not like if you're pushing to like GitHub or whatever, it doesn't touch VPN in the first place, even if you are connected.
Yeah, I'll just to add on to that. When I say I don't have to get on the VPN, that's because when I'm changing code, it's all part of the upstream project, which is all in public GitHub. It's not behind any walls, it's not private or anything. So there's no benefit to being on VPN for that. I could be working from the coffee shop or from the beach if I wanted to contribute to the upstream project. But everything else does sit behind the Great Firewall. The SRE stuff is all gated, of course.
And then I'm going to do this as the final question just because of the time. When you add a new feature, how do you make sure IQE tests are already there as part of the PR gating? And then do your developers write IQE tests?
So right now, the developers don't write the IQE tests. We write our unit tests. We do have the ability to run them, as mentioned, I think, in a previous presentation. It's been a while since I've run them. I know Kat, one of our team members, has recently run them. This is part of what I was saying earlier about you need to work together and collaborate with the QE. So when we're doing our daily standups, we'll mention, hey, I'm working on story XYZ. And I, as a developer, am expecting the QE on the other side of the fence to be listening to what I'm saying and saying, oh, okay, this sounds like an interesting case, or maybe I'll assert, hey, we need to update tests for this because I expect changes to be coming down the pipe. And since the IQ tests are part of the PR check, they will fail if I've done something to the back end to break that, and I can't merge. It is a required check in our pipeline process. Ditto for smoke. If smoke fails, so it'll deploy to stage, smoke will run its tests, and it won't go to prod if smoke is failing.
All right, awesome, thank you. And then Brian mentioned it yesterday, but just to reiterate, one of the OKRs is for this upcoming quarter of 3 months would be for two more groups to do what Brad's team implemented. So if you have any questions or want to try it out or get it going, you know, just re-review this prezo. And of course, you can always reach out to Brad or other people on the team.